snowy, icy afternoon. Central Michigan wins the toss. They defer. Minnesota will get the football first, and we are underway in the Quick Lane Bowl. And a knee taken by Jalen Meyer in the end zone. Third member of our team is down on the sidelines. Her name is Casey Smith. Let's join her now. Hey, Casey.
Hey, Dave. Minnesota has dealt with an unusual amount of injuries this season. In fact, 24 players on the two deep have missed a combined 119 games this season. The coaching staff said they liked they had those extra couple weeks to really get healthy. And this is the healthiest this team has been in the second half of the season. I know Gopher fans are happy that Jalen Myrick and defensive lineman Scott Epe and Steve Richardson will be back. They practiced all week and are expected to be in tonight's game.
Yeah, Casey, it has been just unreal what has happened to this Minnesota team throughout the year in terms of injuries, but coaches certainly had smiles on their face getting some of these guys healthy. They'll run the football in the first play, and a big hole for Rodney Smith, the redshirt freshman, into Central Michigan territory, taken down at the 37-yard line as he picks up 37. What a start for the Golden Gophers.
We got a new offensive coordinator, Rob Reeves, calling the plays, but this is something that Minnesota has done well all season long. They get a pulling guard to the weak side of the formation. They pick up an extra blocker, and you can see the Gopher running backs. We'll see a lot of Rodney Smith as well as Shannon Brooks here in this game. That's a staple of what they want to get established early in this game.
A true freshman and a redshirt freshman will tote the football most of the night for Minnesota. They will go with Smith again. Bounces off one Chippewa defender and gets it inside the 35 down to the 33-yard line. Five more yards. The man that will run the show, Mitch Leidner. He's had a pretty solid season at quarterback. 235-pounder, 6'4". What do you like about his game?
Well, you look at him, he's more mobile than you would otherwise think. Guy could contribute with his legs. Coaches like what they have in him. Felt as if he's given more time. Ability to set up in the pocket, he would be even more effective taking advantage of their weapons out wide.
His 29th start of his Minnesota career. 15-13 are the Gophers in that time span. Oh, nice little hip shake and another first down for Minnesota inside the 25. Brought down by Frazier, who's wearing 21 today. 9-yard pickup.
Kayvon Frazier at the safety position for the Chippewa defense. He's going to have a big game if Minnesota's going to stick with this game plan. The coaches anticipated that the Gophers would come in and try to pound this Chippewa defense. Frazier leads them in tackles. Part of that is because they sneak him down in the box. They try to stack inside. He's playing in the middle of the field, but in run support, he's going to have a big game.
We'll stay on the ground. Not much happening there. You talked about Shannon Brooks, the true freshman out of Atlanta, and the redshirt freshman, Rodney Smith. This is what they have done this year. Pretty good dynamic duo taking over for David Cobb, who ran for 1,600 yards last year.
A school record single-season rushing performance for Cobb a year ago. Thought maybe it would be Roderick Williams to kind of take over the mantle at the running back position, but it has been kind of that 1-2 punch from the two freshmen, one redshirt, one true, has powered their ground game.
Brooks will go in motion. Two tight end set on second down and 10. Leidner will throw over the middle. Pass is caught. K.J. May to the 10. That's another Minnesota first down. His helmet will come off, and the player will have to leave for one play.
K.J. May, very dangerous, lined up in the slot. They got the matchup that they wanted versus a linebacker in space and Malik Fountain. K.J. May is going to be able to make plays versus that matchup all game long. Good route runner, excellent possession receiver as well in traffic.
First down and 10. Ball sits right at the 11-yard line. Great opening drive by Minnesota. Here goes Brooks. He is stuffed. Might have gotten back to the original line of scrimmage. Josh Cox comes up to make the play from his corner position. Cox, the sophomore, and a Warren. 5'11", 190.
Scenario where Central Michigan typically bows their neck. The 14th best red zone defense in the country, and they only allow touchdowns on 56% of those red zone drives. Minnesota has done a good job of asserting themselves. A couple of nice runs on the ground, getting the ball down here. Now they got to come away with points.
Leidner keeps it on that little quarterback replay. Picks up three.
Minnesota runs that a little bit more than you would anticipate. We fully expect to see Demry Croft, true freshman and quarterback, in this game. Because of some of the transition in the coaching staff, we're going to see some personnel that you otherwise wouldn't anticipate. But Mitch Leidner is a guy that in some of their zone read concept can be dangerous when he makes that pull and gets out on the edge.
Minnesota's in the red zone, scored a touchdown only 51% of the time. Not a great number. They'll go with Brooks working the left side. He has hit it to five and pushed back to the 6 yard line. Serpa, the first man there. Frazier comes flying in as well. And now you're looking at fourth down.
You just mentioned it. Watch Kayvon Frazier. Look at his eyes. He's the free hat. There's nobody that's accounted for in him in the blocking scheme. When you got a safety who plays tight to the line of scrimmage, and in the red zone you typically see that. Frazier spends a lot of his time around the line of scrimmage, and right there made a big play.
Santoso to attempt the 22-yard field goal. It is up and it is good. He is now 16 out of 20 on the year. Nice opening drive by Minnesota. The first play from scrimmage picks up 37 yards. Rodney Smith does the damage. The Golden Gophers will take the three, and that is the lead. Early 3-0 lead on their opening drive. Central Michigan trying to answer the bell. Set to receive the kick from Ryan Santoso. And it'll go out of bounds. So some good field position coming to Central Michigan.
Free kick out of bounds. Kicking team. Ball be placed at 35-yard line. First down.
Well, for Central Michigan, they hired John Bonamigo as their head coach, coming back to his alma mater back on February 8th. But then he was diagnosed with tonsil cancer back on June 18th. But he was not going to let that slow him down. He was available and ready to coach the first game. Season got off to a tough start. They lose four of their first six games. But then they got it rolling, winning five of their last six. They played such a tough schedule. Teams like Oklahoma State, Syracuse, Michigan State, Northern Illinois to start the season. But they found some solid footing down the stretch, mainly behind their quarterback, Cooper Rush. Pickup of three on that first play behind Martez Walker. But Cooper Rush was the story. I think he might be the best unknown quarterback maybe in the country.
That's a fair assessment, I think, especially given how valuable he is to his football team. We've already touched on it. From a play calling standpoint, it's kind of balanced. They'll run the football, but it's more of an ornament to the play action pass than it is anything else. The way they get their yards is Cooper Rush delivering the football in the passing game.
That pass is incomplete. What I like about Cooper Rush is the fact that as a freshman, completed 56% of his passes. Last year as a sophomore, 63%, and this year he's up to 67%.
See the improvement over time, and part of that comes with comfort. When you talk to the coaches, offensive coordinator Morris Watts, calling the plays this season was with Dan Enos, the previous head coach. He indicated that Cooper Rush is one of those guys who always knows where he should go with the football and then delivers a strike.
Four-man rush. That ball is knocked away at the last moment. Antonio Johnson gets his right hand in there. And now you're looking at a punting situation and a three and out for the Chippewa offense.
We can talk about Cooper Rush and how well he's played this season, but this Minnesota secondary is a good one. And it got better when they got Myrick back. Number five is going to be out there. Gives them a little bit more depth. Part of the concern that they had coming into this game, and we mentioned it at the top, is just how deep this Chippewa receiving core is and how well they distribute the football. They needed to get more bodies in the secondary and a great opening series for the Gopher defense.
So Brian Evey will handle the punts today and the kicks for Central Michigan. And he sends it to Harden, who is knocked out of bounds. And by the way, for you Central Michigan fans, Ron Caluzzi, your normal punter, right before the team left to come here to Detroit, decided he was going to transfer. So Mr. Evie will have double duty today for the Chippewas. Minnesota has the football when we come back. It's Air Force, then at 5:30, it's the Russell Athletic Bowl as North Carolina takes on Baylor. Then at 9, it's the Advocare V100 Texas Bowl between LSU and Texas Tech. Going deep, first play, and dropped at the 35. Wolitarski had it right in his hands. That would have been a touchdown. Amari Coleman back in coverage.
Wow, they're not going to want to check out that film. Wolitarski, who has really blossomed this season, as have his other mates in the wide receiver room. The guys in a position that really needed to improve. J.J. Mays already with the one catch so far, and that one would have been a big play and likely a touchdown.
Leidner will keep it and get it right back to the 20-yard line, maybe a yard on the play. Malik Fountain, a linebacker, comes up to make the tackle, now with 60 on the season.
See some of the aggressiveness, though, right? Rob Reeves, a play caller, former quarterback, a guy that we kind of anticipated would open things up a little bit. First down, take a shot, and it was there. Wolitarski didn't come up with it. Go back to that ground game, but this is an area where third downs haven't been the biggest friends to the Gopher offense this season. They've had their difficulties.
Chippewas bringing some heat. Leidner gets it away to his tight end, who's having a heck of a season. Lingen with his 29th catch of the year. Three touchdowns. Picks up 10, and that'll be good enough for a first down.
On the third down, you can bet that Mitch Leidner is going to find his tight end in Brandon Lingen. He's going to be a moving part to this offense. Not always lined up on the line of scrimmage. This time you'll see him here hipped right off of the tackle. But they'll flex him out, and he can run excellent routes in space.
Straight handoff, nowhere to run for Rodney Smith. Fountain again coming up to make a play. They're going to say loose. Central Michigan wants the football. But Minnesota will retain possession. Maybe loses a yard on the carry.
See Fountain coming in there, number 31. Rips that football out of there, but I believe the whistle. I heard a whistle early on for forward progress. You'll see these defenders, especially when there's ever a pile, a ball carrier stood up, a receiver. When the cavalry gets there, they're raking that football out in the event that that whistle hadn't blown.
Second down and 11 out of that pistol formation. Leidner comes near side, and that one is incomplete.
Looking for Lingen again. That time covered by Mitch Stanisek. We'll see him line up at the end of the line of scrimmage. That time they were in a three down front. Greg Colby dropping Stanisek, an outside linebacker. Did a good job in coverage versus Brandon Lingen.
This Central Michigan defense, 16th in the country in yards allowed, 33rd in scoring defense, 24th in the country in passing defense. I mean, this is a solid group. On third and 11, they'll go handoff left side to Rodney Smith. He'll pick up 4.5 yards, but well shy the line to make, which was out the 41-yard line. So now you're looking at a punting situation. Tyree Waller comes in to make the play.
See Rob Reeves showing some respect to the Chippewa defense, and you can see why. Excellent pass D. See a top 24, top 25 defense and pass defense. They don't give up a ton of yards, but as we mentioned, that opening drive, Gophers go right down the field, but it's in the red zone where the Chippewas do their best work.
Mortel with a booming kick. A 17-yard line, a 54-yard kick. Thomas on the return. Everything on ESPN is now streaming live on the ESPN app. Download the app right now. Can't get any easier than that. Central Michigan backed up at the 18-yard line. They went three and out on their first possession. An offense that, you know, we just showed you the time of possession. And this is an offense that, holds onto the football. They throw it a ton, and, you know, a lot of coaches disregard that. But for a team that throws it so much, to have the football for over 33 and a half minutes a game is pretty impressive. And off, ooh, big collision. Romello Ross, the true freshman, loses a yard on his first carry.
Nowhere to go with the football that time. Cody Polk coming in from his middle linebacker position. You'll see him lined up right in the middle of the defensive formation. See him right here, number 12. He's just going to come and fill this hole. See, nobody's able to get up off of their blocks. Looks like Joe Bocci, the fullback, number 40, who they'll use him as a tight end at times, as an H-back, was unable to climb up fast enough. Polk did a good job.
He'll dump it off near side. Ross has some room to run. First down for the Chippewas. Out over the 30 to the 32-yard line. Give him 16 yards.
This is just a great play. I don't know, I'm an offensive line. Watch number 77 get out in front and spring his running back on a screen under the outside. Looks like just a regular swing pass out of the backfield, but big number 77, Ramadan Ahmedi, a guy who was a little bit banged up earlier this season. Great job getting out in front and escorting his back, able to pick up the first down.
A little breathing room now. Out to the 39. Gain of six on the play. Anthony Rice with the carry.
Anthony Rice along with Jesse Kroll, Mark Chapman, Corey Willis. They're the four receivers, the Chippewa offense, that allow Cooper Rush to spread the football around. That's another way to get him a touch on a fly sweep out of the offensive backfield. Stretch the defense laterally a little bit. Open up that box.
Second down and four. Here comes Rush. He's close to midfield and run out of bounds. He'll have the first down. Picks up 11 yards. Duke McGee runs him out of bounds. Cooper Rush, the junior, showing you some nice little footwork.
They want to get the fly sweep. Ball to Anthony Rice. Why not let your quarterback open things up on a zone read on the backside? As we mentioned, the running game hasn't produced a ton of yards for the Chippewas, but Morris Watts mentioned that he felt like they could emphasize a little bit more on the ground.
Boy, pressure coming from the outside. Cochran closing quickly on Cooper Rush. He throws it into the ground. It'll be second down and 10. You said run game hasn't picked up a whole lot of yards. They average just 101 yards a game on the ground. That is 125th in the country.
You look at it, you know, without Thomas Rawls, who last year was a 1,000-plus yard rusher for Central Michigan, I don't think that they anticipated such a steep drop-off.
Set up a little screen underneath. Ross trying to fight his way close to the first down. He'll be a yard shy, gets 9 yards on the play. Polk asking to check out of the game.
It's twice now, though. Chippewa offense doing a great job in their screen game. Minnesota's not a great pass rush unit, but you can see the offensive front led by Nick Beamish, number 54, out in front, allowing Ross to get out in the open field. If you can't get the ground game going and get your running backs involved with handoffs, the screen game is another way to get them their touches. That's two on this series.
Needed a yard and a half, and they'll give him three on the carry. First down for the Chippewas.
A little power football this time.
Well, you know Ross is just fired up. Coming back home, he's from Detroit, the true freshman.
A couple nice catches on this drive, and then able to slam it up in there to pick up a first down. That's an attitude run. That's one of those runs in the middle of a series that can lift an entire huddle. You get a big physical run to pick up a first down and continue a drive. Chippewas, after going three and out, establishing a nice drive on this series, eclipsing midfield.
Toss sweep. Ross cuts it back. Nice little move, has another first down. There's a young man that finished his high school career here in Detroit with over 5,000 rushing yards, 84 touchdowns.
This is effectively another screen pass. You see Big Nick Beamish, he ain't quite quick enough to stay in front of Romello Ross, but once again, Rabadon Ahmedi from his left tackle position, able to pull out in front on that toss. Very similar to that swing pass earlier in this possession, and Ross doing a great job following his blockers.
First down and 10, just inside the 30-yard line. Cooper Rush rolling out. Another first down at the 18-yard line. Corey Willis, the sophomore, picks up 11.
You see it already now. It's a couple of touches. They're spreading the football around with Anthony Rice with this fly sweep. Able to get the ball downfield to Corey Willis, but you see the receptions. Jesse Kroll, who's yet to get a target in this game with 59 catches. Anthony Rice right behind him with 56, but so many targets in this passing game for the Chippewas.
Hayes. We'll get it down to the 17-yard line. And, you know, when we talk to Tracy Clays about this Central Michigan team, and, you know, he's a former defensive coordinator before he became the head coach. We said, you know, what's your biggest concern? He says the fact that we don't know who to stop in the pass game. They've got so many guys that have been a factor.
Right. Now, who are you going to focus on exactly? You know, Coach Clays, D coordinator, kind of seeded that over to Jay Sauvel, who is usually coordinating the special teams. Obviously, certainly has his hand in what's going on the defensive side of the football, defensive-minded guy, former offensive lineman. But it was difficult, I think, for them to identify the weapons.
Rush a little bit low with the pass, looking for Willis. It'll be third down and 9.
See the Chippewas moving the pocket. That time rolling to his left, and Rush a little bit off in his accuracy. We've seen a couple passes, especially on that opening series. Not quite as crisp as we've seen on film out of Cooper Rush. A little bit jittery in this game. Needs to settle down and start delivering catchable balls.
Boy, this is a drive that started back at the 18. 12th play coming up right here. Third down and 9. Rush over the middle, pass caught. Down to the 1-yard line. It'll be first and goal after a 16-yard pickup. Ben McCord with the big reception down the middle.
We mentioned early on the weapons, and they're not just at wide receiver. Ben McCord coming into this game, 37 catches on the season. We talk about throwing strikes right in front of Antonio Johnson, one of the senior safeties from Minnesota, one of the mainstays for an excellent secondary. And Ben McCord, as a tight end, making an excellent reception in front of the coverage.
First and goal from the 1. Inside handoff. No signal yet. Shy. It'll be second and goal.
Just snuck it in the belly of Joe Bocci at the fullback position. He lines up so tight behind the quarterback. Sometimes those quick hitters, you can slip your fullback right in there. Linebackers don't have quite enough time to come up and meet the ball carrier. That time, good job by the Gopher defense of defending the goal line.
Boy, 2 fullbacks in the game. He'll go with Hayes. Tries to leap for it. Denied. It'll be third down and goal.
Full house backfield, as you mentioned, 2 fullbacks. And you see there, no push up front, met in the air. And this is part of the reason why a lot of offensive coaches, they don't want their backs to leave their feet. Because if you're met in the air, your momentum is done. That time, Nick Rallis, number 56, able to beat Hayes right in the air.
End of the first quarter. Central Michigan knocking on the door, but Minnesota has the lead after 15 minutes of play. That's how far Central Michigan has to go to take the lead here at the Quick Lane Bowl. Third down and inches. No signal yet. Touchdown, Chippewas. Cooper Rush sticks his nose in there. His third rushing touchdown of the season.
Saw Cooper rush earlier on a zone read. This time, finishing up this drive on the ground with his legs. Right there, right behind the block of Kenny Rogers, big number 75, the right guard position. Missed the first couple of games of the year. He got just enough push to get his quarterback into the end zone.
That is just a sea of humanity down there.
That's a lot of bodies.
It's crazy. Evie's point after is up and good. Cooper Rush has thrown for a bunch of touchdowns, 25 of them this year, but he rushes for one and lost. By the way, I'd feel a lot better if I was a Cincinnati or Denver fan if New England wasn't playing Miami next week. But that's the scenario for the and the importance of the game tonight between those two teams featuring A.J. McCarron and Brock Osweiler at quarterback. Who would have ever thunk that?
Yeah, coming into the year. That's not the marquee matchup that everybody had drawn up. Either way, though, both of those teams finding ways to get it done.
Yeah, and they're doing it with defense. Those are two really, really good defenses on display tonight. So Minnesota will get the football out the 25-yard line. Great drive by Central Michigan. We saw Cooper Rush do what he does, and that's just make plays. And now we get a chance to see what Mitch Leidner has in response, trailing by four. Second quarter just underway, 14:55 to go. Dave Neal, Matt Stinchcomb, Casey Smith, glad you could join us here in Detroit. It is, the sky's opened up. A lot of snow and sleet. Perfect.
You never know when this dome makes you happy for the roof, man.
First down and 10. Four-man rush. Boy, nice throw. Looking for Wolitarski, but nice throw by Leidner just over the outstretched hands of the defender. Very catchable ball.
That's twice now. In the last series, Leidner was looking for Wolitarski on first down, downfield. Wolitarski's got his hands on both of those balls and incapable of coming up with a reception behind the coverage. Gonna have to shake it off because he has been a big part of what Minnesota has done in the passing game. This Leidner is gonna need Wolitarski to start coming up with those.
They'll hand it off to Shannon Brooks. On a little sweep play, and he'll have the first down out to the 44-yard line, a 19-yard pickup. Nice play. They split the freshman running back out wide, brought him across the formation.
Had Rodney Smith lined up in the backfield, and Brooks was split out. Great job, giving him some nice momentum, getting all the way outside. Rodney Smith, his backfield mate number 24, had a nice block as well to spring his buddy. A couple of freshmen from Georgia enjoying a nice season on the ground for the Gophers.
Straight handoff to Brooks. Right in the teeth of that defense. Brooks was a guy. I mean, this, I'm not going to say he was a guy they found that nobody knew about. He was the Georgia Class 4A Offensive Player of the Year last year. Ran for 2,200 yards, 32 touchdowns. Ran for 176 yards against Purdue, 174 yards against Illinois State. The guy had some talent coming out of high school. And he just liked Minnesota.
Look at the coaches and coaching staff. They get down there. They said, look, you can't just stay in Metro Atlanta. You got to kind of expand your horizons. You got a good one at Brooks.
Wide open at the Central Michigan 40-yard line. Lingen, another catch, 14 yards and a first down.
So easy for them to slip him out. Here's Lingen again. As we mentioned, he'll usually be hipped off the line of scrimmage. Watch him wiggle right in front of Kayvon Frazier. See number 21 bailing, unaccounted for that time. He was cleared out by the deep route. Lincoln settling in right behind the linebackers and in front of the safeties.
Golden Gophers will work out of that pistol. They'll hand it off to Brooks. He's got some running room to the 20, to the 15, and out of bounds at the 10-yard line. A 30-yard pickup.
Dave, I mentioned how much they like this weak side power. This is the same play that we saw that rip off a big run in the first quarter, first play of the game. And you can see Shannon Brooks got a great feel. That time he hit it backside. John Christensen was pulling from his left guard position. See, Brooks found the hole right where his guard had vacated on the pull.
Looking to throw into the end zone. Touchdown, Minnesota. KJ DJ May, his fifth touchdown reception of the year from 11 yards out. And that is how you answer.
That was an authoritative drive by the Gophers. They had an opportunity on their first possession. You see there, Amari Coleman was right underneath of that ball and had an opportunity to make a play on it in the air. He and Tony Anise came over there late. Great job by KJ May of coming up with that football in traffic on a contested throw.
Six plays, 75 yards. Pretty solid. Leidner now with 14 touchdown passes on the year. And Minnesota back out in front here in the second quarter in Detroit. This team's leading receiver is 66th reception of the year, fourth all time at Minnesota for a single season. That one went for 11 yards and a touchdown. As Minnesota takes the lead, 10-7. Emmett Thomas from 1 yard. Hit at the 17 and falls out to the 19-yard line. Let's go downstairs, get an update with Casey.
Well, Dave, we saw Minnesota defensive lineman Yashub Timms go down on that last defensive series. They did wrap his left ankle. He's running up and down the sideline, getting down in his stance. The athletic trainer gave me a thumbs up. It looks like he's going to be good to go.
We'll keep an eye on him. He gets to jog onto the field and then jog right back off. So I guess they were just testing his
throw. Trying to keep him loose.
He's like, come on, man.
And of course, the ball would be on the far hash. Big men hate that.
Here's Rush looking to throw, coming near side. Diving catch made by Kroll. Kroll now with 60 catches on the year.
This is unbelievable body control by Kroll. Watch him redirect his entire body. He's coming back out of his cut. That ball was outside wide. Cooper Rush, he was dialed in on his touchdown throw on that previous possession, but he's been a little bit off the mark a couple times. That time, his wide receiver doing some work for him to make him look good.
Second down, 7. That one is dropped by Kroll.
Turnabout. That time, ball's right on the money. Cooper Rush even able to deliver that football under duress. Cody Pope coming from his linebacking position, able to get a shot on the quarterback. Chippewas usually do a very good job of getting the football out quickly. Part of that's a function of Rush's decision making, where he wants to go with the ball and getting it out fast. Haven't given up a ton of sacks all season long, do a pretty good job of keeping their quarterbacks clean.
Central Michigan, 1 out of 3 on third down conversions. Rush steps up at the pocket, looking to run for it. Sees a little seam, and he'll have it out at the 31.5-yard line. Give him 9 on the little scamper. Took a little stutter step and then saw some room and just went for it.
Yeah, dead-legged him a little bit. Who saw that coming? We talk about Mitch Leidner. He's a pretty mobile guy at quarterback. Cooper Rush, we've seen in this game twice now, taking advantage of it. Won the zone read. That time just being opportunistic, finding a rush lane, but he didn't have anywhere he wanted to go with the football.
Hand off to Ross. Ross picks up 3.5, maybe 4. Boone Lay, Iade brings him down. And an injured Chippewa. There's Anthony Rice, the wide receiver, limping off.
As we mentioned, Central Michigan's got great depth at wide receiver, and at the same time, they're playing with 4 wide receivers. You see, that's a big collision. Antonio Johnson coming up in this safety position. Nice shot in on Anthony Rice, had to lead the game.
Second down and 7. Straight handoff. Ross out over the 40. You know, Ross is one of those guys that in a bowl situation, Matt, where, you know, during the year, he gets 35 carries, 147 yards. But you get that extra couple of weeks of practice, he's one of those guys that maybe the coach says, wait a minute.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? In our call, Morris Watts, he says, look, we got a true freshman in Romello Ross. He's a guy that you're going to look for. He has really come on back into the season in a bowl practices. You cannot put enough value on these opportunities for these teams, young guys especially. They finally get it. They push through that freshman wall, and in that postseason can really make their presence felt.
Ross again cuts it back. Nice move to midfield. Picks up 11 yards.
Watch Nick Bemis in his center position, number 54, pulling out and around. Nice finish. And Romello Ross, tell you what, for a true freshman, he's shown me on these screen passes, on a toss. He does a great job waiting, setting up those blocks, not wasting time, but waiting until those blocks get established and then bursting upfield. Big conversion on the ground.
That one is almost picked off. Brian Body Calhoun almost had his hands on it. Corey Willis was the intended receiver.
Talk about what a great route runner Corey Willis is. You see him underneath it. This ball hangs a little bit late and allows Body Calhoun to adjust and come back underneath. You see Willis ends up being the defensive back on that one to try to preserve the possession. Fighting for that football in the air. Otherwise, Brian Body Calhoun is going to come up with a pick going the other way.
Second down and 10 for the Minnesota 49-yard line. Loss of two on the play. Nice job by Nick Rawlis, the junior middle linebacker. He's made a couple of big plays today for Minnesota.
Sure has. I mean, on that goal line earlier on, he was able to beat the running back Jare Hayes right in the air. Forced the big third down. That time, a nice tackle for loss. Central Michigan, all season long, they've been able to overcome these scenarios. Third and 10 plus. Cooper Rush is completing 70% of his passes when it's 10 or more. He's done an excellent job of converting these difficult thirds.
Tries to dump it off underneath to Ben McCord. Can't hang on. And once again, Minnesota stands up defensively and forces what appears to be a punting situation. But hold on, the offense staying on the field for a moment, and looks like they're going to go for it. Fourth down and 12 from midfield.
Wow, that's aggressive to say the least. When you look at it, you're in a three-point game. There's a half of a quarter left to play here. He's seeding excellent field position on a fourth and 10 plus.
And Minnesota all discombobulated.
They can't believe it either.
Hope nothing else. They got Minnesota to burn a timeout.
That's right.
John Bonamigo, longtime special teams coach in the National Football League for 16 years before coming.
No defensive coordinator. They haven't made an announcement on who's going to replace Will Muschamp there in Auburn. It's an interesting time of year. You see all these coaching staffs in flux like this.
Well, Coach Bonamigo has decided to punt it away. Maybe he was just trying to get him to burn a timeout. Play a little head game with him.
I guess. But I'll tell you what, if that was it, mission accomplished. Otherwise.
Well, we told you about the fact that Ron Caluzzi no longer punting. This time we're going to see Zach Oakley punt it away. Normally a defensive back for Central Michigan. And he does a nice job, a little soccer rugby style type of kick. It'll go out of bounds inside the 10 at the 9-yard line. Mitch Leidner, boy, 5 of 8, 67 yards and a TD back on the field when we return. Museum in Dearborn, the official welcome dinner of the Quick Lane Bowl. As we are in Detroit, Ford Field, Central Michigan and Minnesota. Dave Neal, Matt Stinchcomb, Casey Smith with you. Glad you could join us tonight. Minnesota leading it 10-7, 8:48 to go here in the second frame. Minnesota's last drive, very impressive. Six plays, 75 yards, 2 minutes, 12 seconds to take the lead over Central Michigan as Rodney Smith with the carry picks up a yard and a half. But last drive was a nice job. A lot of, you know, they had a little sweep in there. They did a little straight handoff, tied him. It mixed it up very well.
Yeah, I liked it. Yeah, a lot of very versatile approach to the offense. Didn't get hung up in any one phase of the game. Got touches to everybody. Shannon Brooks on the fly sweep. Very creative.
Leidner. Out to the 15-yard line. It's Drew Wolitarski. Gain of four. Josh Cox on the coverage. Now you're looking at about a third down and about four.
Wolitarski, I'm sure they're happy to see him come up with that one after a couple of drops that targeted him on the back-to-back first downs in the opening series. That time Leidner going right back to him, needing to get him incorporated, make sure that confidence is there so that he can have a willing target in the passing game at number 82.
Four-man rush over the middle. Oh, a couple of big collisions. But K.J. May will hold on to it and pick up the first down, a 9-yard pickup.
It's a couple of nice catches now that we've seen by May. Comes in motion, gets underneath. Amari Coleman coming up in coverage again. Saw him undercut the route on the touchdown catch. That time May able to get underneath it. Once again, you see the focus, the leading receiver for the Gophers. Part of the reason why he's come up 67 catches so far this season.
Side handoff. Well, Kayvon Frazier wearing normally number 5, but today wearing number 21. For more on that story, let's go down to Casey.
Well, Dave, earlier this summer, teammate Derek Nash passed away battling leukemia, and wearing number 21 has been a point of pride for this team. A different player each week, named by the coaches based on their performance, and Kayvon Frazier is the only player who's worn that jersey 2 times this year, a point of pride for him.
Yeah, boy, it's it was a tough offseason for Central Michigan, and what an honor it is to wear that 21 if you're a Chippewa. And there's a loose football. I haven't seen a signal yet.
I definitely heard a whistle. That's twice we've seen it. Malik Fountain earlier on the opening series thought he ripped the ball out. And I'll tell you what, I think that ball was coming out before we heard that whistle in the replay. Kelby Lotta coming in there, and it looked like that ball had already started to slip out of Rodney Smith's hands.
Minnesota on third down. Leidner steps up in the pocket, will throw over the middle, and that one is picked off. Josh Cox. No whistle involved in that turnover. And Central Michigan will have it at the 45-yard line.
Looked to me almost like Leidner might have crossed the line of scrimmage. He hadn't. But it was Tony Anise and his safety spot underneath was able to tip that football. And Cox was able to come up with the pick. After Kelby Lotta looked to me in the replay whether he ripped the football out. See there, Leidner, all it takes is one part of his body to still be behind the line of scrimmage to be a legal forward pass. And it was big turnover for the Chippewas.
11th interception of the year by Leidner. Cooper Rush getting pressure and has to throw it away. Central Michigan trying to take advantage of the turnover, but you got to understand about this Minnesota defense. Despite the injuries, and they've had a number of injuries, especially defensively, they have yet to allow a 300-yard passer, not just this season, but last season as well. 24 straight games they have gone without giving up 300 yards through the air, and they're facing a guy that does it all the time.
Right. No, it's remarkable, and a lot of stress on that secondary because they don't get great pressure.
No flags, incompletes. It'll be third down and 10.
You see Jesse Kroll.
So let me answer the question. You're not getting a lot of pressure on the quarterback. Your secondary's banged up. How are they able to to manage it.
Well, one of the things is they're excellent tacklers in space. When you look at them, they're one of the best among the Power Five. Yards after the catch, they only allow about 4 yards. So if you do make a reception in front of this secondary, they're going to get you on the ground shortly thereafter. They don't allow a lot of runaway after the catches.
Bringing the house. Nobody's there. They didn't get a sack. And there will be grounding. There was nobody in the area. I don't think it got past the line of scrimmage.
Offense, number 10, threw the ball into an area where there was no eligible receiver. That's a loss of down at the spot of the foul. Be fourth down.
Gophers had their cheetah package of sorts in there. Just two bigs in the game. Rest for linebackers. Julian Huff, number 20, coming off the edge. You mentioned they don't get great pressure, and right on cue, Gopher defense able to get Cooper Rush off of his spot. This game, that's their fourth pressure that they've got.
I mean, it really is crazy. The only 20 sacks this year by Minnesota. That's 12th in the Big Ten.
What's crazier, only two quarterback hurries the whole season.
Boy, nice catch on the run by Hart. Trying to go far side and a collision at the 25-yard line. So Minnesota's defense playing very well. Gives their offense another chance after the turnover. Back in a moment.
The college football playoff semifinals, New Year's Eve on ESPN.
Cal and Air Force, the Russell Athletic Bowl, North Carolina and Baylor. And then I think one that I think a lot of people are looking at just because they want to see what Leonard Fournette does, the Advocare V100 Texas Bowl, LSU and Texas Tech. And can Texas Tech slow down Mr. Fournette after maybe the Heisman snub and a little chip on his shoulder? And
I think the only thing stopping him in that one is leg cramps. You better stay hydrated.
Leidner on first down will throw to the far side. A couple of yards on the reception by Lingen. And Mr. Frazier with another tackle for those.
A big turnover by the Chippewa defense. Able to give their offense great field position, but Gophers able to hold serve, get the ball right back. Leidner's done a relatively good job all season protecting the football. A little bit greedy on that last possession, trying to hit it down over the middle.
Leidner keeps it. Nice fake to Rodney Smith, who took a shot for the team. A couple of yards for Leidner.
It's the thing with the zone read, you know, that running back, it's almost like an option quarterback. You know, you're not going to end up with the football, but you are going to get hit anyway.
Leidner has rushed for 1,100 yards in his career.
He's a good runner when you look at it. Number two all time in rushing touchdowns from the quarterback position. Came into this game with 22 of them. He can be dangerous with the ball in his hands.
Three-man rush. A.J. May with the reception. Boy, he has a really good feel for where that first down line is. Picks up 7, and he needed 6 for the first down.
So great hands on this catch as well. Nice body control. Working inside. You see there Tyree Waller dropping from his linebacking position right there in front of Amari Coleman. A nice soft spot in that zone. And May, what a nice game so far to go with that touchdown reception.
Rodney Smith really nowhere to run, but will pick up a couple of yards on the carry.
Play's been good to Minnesota in this game so far. They've ripped off a couple of nice ones, but that time one cut too many by Rodney Smith, and as active as Central Michigan is from the safety position and run support, can't afford to spend too much time in the line of scrimmage. By the time they've diagnosed, Kayvon Frazier's going to come crashing down from his safety spot along with Tony Anise.
Second down and 8. Riding with a little play fake. Catch made right at midfield. Wozniak, the tight end, picks up 11. You can move the chains for the Golden Gophers.
Woz, the tight end that usually is attached at the end of the line of scrimmage. They use him as a blocker most of the time. This time, though, as a drag all the way across the formation, you see him there. Nice ball placement by Leidner, away from Kayvon Frazier, who was sinking back in coverage. Wozniak getting into the game, only 7 catches on the season coming into this matchup.
Leidner, he'll be dropped back at the 42-yard line. Jabari Dean, the junior from right here in Detroit, picks up his first sack of the year, a loss of 6.
Minnesota had a full slide protection, meaning all the offensive linemen had help working against true freshman Tyler Moore. It looked like he was expecting Joe Bjorklund to help him a little bit more. Jabari Dean able to split the center and right guard. Minnesota get a big sack and a negative yardage play.
Timeout on the field. We'll step aside for...
Probably can't find a better tutor this offense than Adam Weber, a guy who's got his names on just about every passing record list in that Minnesota history and in their media guys.
There have been a lot of changes going on in Minnesota since Tracy Claes was named the head coach, not interim, but the full-time head coach. On second down and 16, incomplete, looking for Eric Carter. So third down, or actually they're going to call it a completed catch, so third down at about 11. But here are those coaching changes. It's been crazy.
You see the changes, you know, Matt Linegrover and Jim Zabrowski there at the bottom. Those guys were the quarterback and offensive line coach respectively. So you've got what were grad assistants, quality control coaches, and Jay Nunez being elevated to work with an offensive line that's had 8 different lineups this season.
They'll swing it out to Brooks. He is bumped out of bounds at the 47-yard line. Clock will stop at 1:45. You punt it away here?
Looks like they are. Play field position. You see that the Gophers did a good job on the quick change off of the turnover. The defense getting the ball back to their offense. Both of these defenses now giving their offense another crack at it before halftime. That time, good job by Central Michigan off of the sack, getting the negative yardage play. The Gophers only able to chip away at the yardage needed.
This ball will hit at the 2 and bounce back at the 5. Doesn't get much better than that, folks.
Wow.
Peter Mortell, the senior, out of Green Bay with a 41-yard kick, and that is almost perfect.
It's like a remote control football, right? He got that for Christmas, kicked it down there, hit it on the 4-yard line, and used his joystick to steer it out of bounds.
That's the one gift I think my kids didn't get this year.
They got hooked up like that, huh? Mortell definitely got it. Look at that. You see the coverage team getting down there on this turf. I mean, it just rolled laterally right there inside the 5. You see Mortell, he's fired up. He should be.
That's about as fired up as a punter gets right
there.
That's right.
Yep. Inside the 5. Of course, you can see why they would think play field position, get the Chippewas a long field.
We're going to go handoff. Romello Ross, not to the 12, give him 5 yards.
Got a timeout in their pocket, but in the deep side of the field, you can see him really no sense of urgency. You have to think that perhaps they're just playing for halftime and try to bleed this clock, unless they rip off a big play here and get it within striking distance.
Tell you what, they have done a number on Cooper Rush, who was on the year averaging 308 yards passing. He is now 5 for 14, 55 yards through the air. Ross again on the carry, picks up 6. That's a first down. 46 seconds to go before halftime.
They really have, Dave. You mentioned it a couple of times, moving him off of his spot. Central Michigan, as we mentioned, do a relatively good job protecting the passer. He has been hurried really early on. You could see wasn't quite as dialed in as we've seen him in other games. Watching them coming up to this matchup, a couple of errant throws, at least errant for his standards. Credit the Minnesota defense. They've done a good job in that secondary.
Rush breaks a tackle. Ross out to the 35-yard line. Gain of 17. Well, a little different story for Cooper Rush. Last year in the flag is down. Last year in the Popeyes Bahamas Bowl, Cooper Rush threw for 453 yards. A school record, 7 touchdowns. In that shootout with Western Kentucky. Not quite the same, well, not quite the same dynamic outside.
No, definitely not. The climate is somewhat different. That's right. That's right. Regardless of the climate control environment.
After the play was over, dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 82 of the offense. That's a 15-yard penalty. It will still be a first down and 10. That's number 82's first unsportsmanlike act of the game.
Corey Willis. You know, he's responding. He can't do it the second time, though, but Eric Murray came in there. Saw Willis give a little bit of a shot to Brian Body Calhoun first. They always see the guy who does it the second time.
Coming up at the half on our Coke Zero halftime report, Reese, Butch, Desmond from South Beach previewing Capital One Orange Bowl. Kirk from Dallas previewing the Goodyear Cotton Bowl. That's so much more as that'll be coming your way in just a couple of minutes. As that'll do it for the first half. Minnesota with a great defensive performance. Cooper Rush, 5 for 15, 55 yards, no TDs, no interceptions. Young man having just a great season, but Minnesota gave him all he wanted. And the Golden Gophers lead it after 30 minutes of football, 10-7. They're trying to push the teams that are 5-7 on the year to go to 3-0. San Jose State beat Georgia State. Nebraska knocks off UCLA. Now Minnesota trying to hang on, knock off Central Michigan. It's a 10-7 game here at the half of Detroit, the Quick Lane Bowl. Let's go down to Casey.
Coach, you're holding Cooper Rush to 55 passing yards. What has this defense done in the first half?
Excuse me, I didn't hear you.
Cooper Rush with only 55 passing yards in the first half. What have you seen from your defense?
Well, you know, we've got a lot of DBs. We got them back, and we're healthy and up front. I think we're making him throw the ball pretty quick. We got to adjust to the screen a little bit. They've hurt us with the screens, and we get that shut down, we'll be in pretty good shape.
Offensively, what do you want to see happen in the rest of the game? Well,
we got to be more consistent up front. You know, we've blown a pass protection, had a chance to big play, dropped a couple balls. We just need to be a lot more cleaner on offense.
Thanks, Coach.
All right, thanks.
Thank you, Casey. Our halftime score, Minnesota leads Central Michigan 10-7. Time now to go to Reese Davis in the studio for our Coke Zero halftime report. But we're inside, thankfully. Ford Field, Minnesota, Central Michigan. Second time these clubs have ever met. The last one was back in 1987 at the Metrodome. 30-10 win for Minnesota in that game. Central Michigan won a share of the MAC West title this year with four other teams, but Northern Illinois won the tiebreaker, played Bowling Green in the championship game of the MAC. Bowling Green won that contest. Minnesota with a good first half defensively really did a number on Central Michigan. Came in high-powered passing attack, held them to 55 yards passing, came in over 300 yards per game through the air, and the Chippewas will have the football first. Let's go get an update. Casey Smith, what do you got?
Well, Dave, I talked to Central Michigan head coach John Bonamigo after the halftime, and he said that this game has been great back-and-forth game on both sides of the ball. Defensively, he wants to see them take more opportunities that the offense is giving them. And offensively, just like you mentioned, they struggled in the first half. He said that this Minnesota secondary is giving them a lot of problems and that they're playing more bump and run than they anticipated, and they look to adjust to that in the second half.
Well, we'll see what kind of adjustments they have right out of the gate. First down and 10 from the 25. All told, this Central Michigan offense put together just 142 yards of offense. They'll stay with the true freshman, Romello Ross. Stitz, take a look at some of those first half highlights.
You saw the Chippewas get going early. Romello Ross, as you mentioned, with that carry, a couple of nice screen catches before Cooper Rush was able to find his tight end and Big McCord to get it right there down on the 1 yard line, ultimately getting it in on a quarterback sneak. But Minnesota answered on the ensuing possession, did a great job on the fly sweep, getting the ball to Shannon Brooks and KJ May on the other end of Mitch Leitner's touchdown pass.
Cooper Rush, Dumps it off underneath. Ross out to the 32-yard line. Give him 8 yards. It'll be third down and a couple for the Chippewas.
Hasn't been a lot of offensive yardage to be had for the Chippewas other than that touchdown drive. But one of the things they have done well, Tracy Clays mentioned this heading into half when he was talking with Casey, is getting the ball to Romello Ross out of the backfield in the screen game and on some of the swing passes. Gopher seeking to do a little bit better job. They played great in the first half. That's the one area that they can clamp down on.
Incomplete. Looking for Corey Willis.
A little bit surprised at some of these slower developing plays. You know, that time, a little bit of pressure. Shoot, Timms was able to get in there. Connor, or Cooper Rush, rather, had to move off of his spot. Hadn't gone after Bobby Calhoun a lot in this game. He's a guy that they felt like they could complete some passes in front of.
And Central Michigan decides they want to go for it here on fourth down and two. Cooper Rush in the shotgun. He's got a little pooch kick that gets a great roll inside the 20, inside the 15. Well done, a 55-yard punt from Cooper Rush, and now Minnesota backed up at the 12-yard line. Well, it's the New Year Six, two of the greatest days for college football fans, and it all starts at noon Eastern, New Year's Eve on ESPN. Then at 4 and 8, the playoff semifinal games between Oklahoma and Clemson and Michigan State and Alabama. Then on New Year's Day, three more tremendous games to kick off 2016. All these games are on ESPN or streaming live on the ESPN app. Hard to believe we are coming to a close of 2015.
A wild ride, hasn't it?
Remember when everybody thought we were freaking out when we hit 2000?
Yeah, right. Y2K.
Right.
Made it 15 years, man.
Everybody getting their money out of the bank accounts. Remember all
that's
that?
That's right. It's a decade and a half. Somehow we've muddied our way forward.
Malik Fountain hits Shannon Brooks. I didn't have any money to get out of check.
It didn't matter.
Right.
Hey, go ahead. Computers could all crash. We weren't as reliant on them then anyway.
Minnesota. An offense coming into this one averaging 22.5 points a game. 13th in the Big Ten, 104th in the country. Rush for 143 yards a game. Last year averaged 215 a game. But may be onto something with these freshman running backs. There's one of them right there, the true freshman. Shannon Brooks, who always looks like he's just one step away from a huge game.
We've seen a couple of nice runs from Brooks when he's lined up in the backfield, but now we've seen him twice where they blow him through the backfield, they'll split him out wide, and they'll try to get it stretched to the perimeter. We mentioned this, something we anticipated, as did the Central Michigan coaches. They felt like we were going to see a little bit more of this out of the play calling of Rob Reeves. Open it up just a little, still do what they're best at, but incorporate some of those concepts on the perimeter.
On third down, I think that'll be enough. Brooks hit by Ricketts. They'll move the chains, fresh set of downs.
So you got a fly sweep in there earlier, and then you go right back to the weak side power that's held them in good stead just about all game. Brooks has got a great feel for that run. Do a good job of getting pulling guards up and into the hole. Gets you an extra hat, especially even when you've got a fullback, and even when you don't. See that lead blocker up into the hole of Brooks. Good job of setting those blocks on the ground game.
The fake the fly sweep. Going down the middle of the field. Pass is caught at the 40-yard line. Drew Olatarski with a big catch. They'll spot it at the 38, a 40-yard pickup for the Golden Gophers.
They've been going to Olatarski a couple of times in this game. Well, in the second series, they had him behind the coverage. Olatarski couldn't rein it in. That was a beautiful pass from Mitch Leitner. That is a strike right out of the beyond the outstretched arm of Josh Cox in coverage, who was running right there with Olatarski. Big number 82 able to come down with that big catch.
Boy, nice move by Brooks.
like this set. They've got Rodney Smith in the backfield, but they'll split out Brooks. We've seen it a couple of times where it's worked well. We're able to get him over there to the edge, and then when the defense over-pursues and they're working to get over there, Brooks is able to see those cutback lanes, gets back across the grain, and able to pop the big runs.
First down and 10 from the 23-yard line. Boy, Rob Reeves acting as the OC in this one has done a nice job mixing up the plays for Minnesota. Leitner under pressure. He'll be hit and dropped. Pocket collapsed as soon as he set up on his drop. Stanisek will get credit for the sack. Pressure came from Palmer.
Lewis Palmer right away, and it's just a blown. That's a blown assignment right there at the right guard position. Joe Bjorklund, who's got to be one of their most valuable players this year. He's played at left guard, at center, at right guard. But that's twice in this game where the right guard and center, Tyler Moore, have been on different pages. Both have resulted in sacks and big negative yardage plays.
Boy, second down and 19. They'll go handoff with Rodney Smith. He'll pick up three. Boy, that was a big-time loss. And a perfect time for Central Michigan to slow down Minnesota.
Boy, you said it. That's exactly right, because Minnesota was clicking. And you can see Central Michigan very much back on their heels. Rob Reeves dialing it up. Just about whatever he wanted, it seemed like it was working on this drive. But that's all it takes is one lap, something that Coach Clay's mentioned at halftime as well. And you get those mental assignments and get blown. The next thing you know, you get a big negative yardage play. It takes you right out of rhythm.
Leitner steps up in the pocket and decides to run for it. Long way to go and short time to get there, and is well shy. Picks up five, but now it'll be fourth down and about 10. Here comes the kicking unit.
Burt Reynolds was in the booth there for a second there, Dave. Fantastic reference.
Thank you.
Look at Leitner. There's a guy that we mentioned. He can run. He visits with Adam Weber there on the sideline. That's a missed opportunity for the Minnesota offense, no question about it. The way that they were working that football, they end up with a field goal attempt.
Santoso with the 41-yarder splits the uprights. So from 22, he converts earlier in the day. Big reception down the middle of the field for Drew Wolitarski. Sets him up for the three-pointer. Now a six-point advantage for the Golden Gophers. 15-7, Dave Neal, Matt Stinchcomb, and Casey Smith with you. From Detroit, Michigan. It used to be the Motor City Bowl and the Little Caesars Bowl. Little pooch kick. Nobody can catch it out of bounds. And now Central Michigan's going to have exceptional field position.
Trying to steal a possession right there.
Hey, New Year's Eve on ESPN.
Free kick out of bounds. Kicking team. Like 5 yards.
It's the college football playoff semifinals, the games we've been waiting for all season at 4 Eastern, the Capital One Orange Bowl, as Oklahoma battles Clemson. Then at 8, it's Michigan State and Alabama, the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Truly the most wonderful time of the year. Both games are on ESPN and streaming live on the ESPN app. Well, if you're Central Michigan, you need a little break. I think Minnesota just gave you one. Short field at the 50-yard line.
Unbelievable. Yeah, I mean, that's pretty aggressive considering you're only up by 6 points. I like the way your offense was moving the football, but...
And Central Michigan hadn't been moving it at all. Why not give them a long field, right? So they'll work out of the classic I formation, fullback lead. And here goes Romello Ross. He'll pick up five to the 45-yard line. Boy, Ross is getting a ton of work for a guy that came into this game with just 35 carries. Ross now with 13 for 65.
Well, right there ended right before halftime. The bulk of his carries had 60 yards at the half. 28 of those were on that last kind of throwaway possession. But he's really made his presence felt, not only as a ball carrier, but as a receiver out of the backfield.
Second down and 5. Boy, that didn't work. Ross gets the carry, but the true freshman Julian Huff came crashing in to make the play, a loss of four.
This is one you don't see very often, where the left tackle and the right tackle pull in opposite directions and pass one another in the backfield. I've seen a lot of different blocking schemes, but that's one I've never come across before. That one is probably doomed from the get-go. Crossing pattern in your own backfield.
Third down and nine. Central Michigan, 5 for 9 on third downs. Over the middle. Pass is caught, first down for the Chippewas. Anthony Rice picks up 11. Nice throw from Cooper Rush.
Nice throw, good protection. Had a nice, wide, clean pocket to step into this throw. Brian Body Calhoun was in coverage. Anthony Rice, one of Cooper Rush's favorite targets in their passing game. Saw him get a touch as a rusher. Hasn't gotten a lot of touches in this game. But frankly, that's been a function of the Central Michigan offense not really possessing the football for long stretches.
Rush going deep. Jesse Kroll broke inside. Ball was outside. He got twisted up, and it's incomplete.
Pocket was collapsing around Cooper Rush. He stood tall, was able to deliver this football. But you can see, you're exactly right. Kroll was working back inside. Rush expecting him to break it back towards the pylon. You see him throwing it under duress. Taking the shot right there by Scott Ekpe, who they've missed him for stretches across that defensive front during the season.
Second down and 10. Quick throw near side. Boy, Anthony Rice missed a block and nearly got his receiver, Corey Willis, destroyed.
You can see it right away, too. Rice missed that block, and he just stood there. And he knew that he blew it. Problem is, what you have to try to do is get up and rally. If he's able to break that first tackle, you get downfield and block somebody else. Good job by Body Calhoun getting upfield, getting that tackle for loss.
Calhoun with 5 tackles today. A couple of passes broken up. A tackle behind the line. Third down and 10 coming up. Boy, that one goes to Hayes and Redwell by Minnesota. No gain on the play. Huff with his 4th tackle. I'll tell you something, impressed with this Minnesota defense.
Did a good job that time. They ran a line stunt right into the side of the line of scrimmage where Central Michigan was trying to set up yet another screen pass. See number 20? He's just coming on a line stunt and got thrown really into that tackle by right tackle Derek Edwards. Wasn't necessarily well read. It was just a perfect call right into that screen.
Evie punts it away, and it will be into the end zone. Chippewas had a chance to down it at the 1. Couldn't do it. Minnesota stands up tall defensively. They'll have the football when we come back.
The players obviously so happy you're here. What is this moment like for you to be back on these sidelines?
Well, it's great to be back on the sideline and be with our players. It's hard at the same time as it's different after doing it for so long and just being a fan, so to speak. But it's been great because I love our players, and this game's about players.
How have the players helped you through this transition?
They've been great to me. They text me all the time. We've stayed in touch, There's a relationship. We've all gone through a lot together, and I love them.
When you look at this program and one of your best friends now being the head coach, what is the future like for this football team?
Well, I think the future is great because I always said that the program would really turn in year 6 and 7, and I think the schedule's going to be a lot different. Players are going to be a lot older. Recruiting's going well, so it's in good hands, and I think our best years are ahead of us.
Thank you so much, Coach.
I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Casey. Great to see him. He looks great. And obviously, you know, it's been a rough road for Coach Kill the past few years with those health issues. And, you know, I was back in 2013 when they played Syracuse in a bowl game. I know that was a tough year for him. Missed the first seven games. Tracy Clays handled that part of the season. He came back for the bowl game. That's his best friend right there. Those guys have been together for 20 years. So it's got to be some solace that his buddy's taken over.
Sure, yeah. And you look at the coaching staff. A lot of these coaches, they came with Coach Kill. A lot of these guys kind of learned the game, cut their teeth, got their opportunities with him as well.
Lewis Palmer, Mitch Stanciak. Stanciak comes in for a second sack of the day. A flag is down in the secondary, however. The flag's back at the 46-yard line. Big 12 officiating crew today, by the way.
I'm surprised we didn't get a holding call on the left guard. That's a strange spot for the flag to end up in.
Prior to the sack. Holding, defense, number 21. That 10-yard penalty will be enforced from the previous spot. The yardage is enough for a first down.
Oh, boy.
It's Kayvon Frazier. And we've mentioned how active he is for this defense, but he's matched up with Brandon Lingan, who, at his tight end position, you know, he's such a good route runner, good in space, of course. That can be a stress on the safety position. Frazier, too active while the ball's in the air.
Working out of the pistol formation, handoff left side goes to Shannon Brooks, picks up a couple of yards. Brooks averaging at around 6 yards a carry.
He's an explosive playmaker. Coming into this game, 44 plays of 25 yards or more, 10 of them by that man, number 27, Shannon Brooks. And we can see, you know, he's quick twitch.
Doesn't it feel like he has more than 49 yards on the ground?
It does. It does.
Try to get to the outside. Cuts it back. Boy, he is shifty.
You see that explosive guy. It's a great way for them to get both of their ball carriers into the offensive formation. They offset Rodney Smith, and then they just flex Shannon Brooks out of the backfield and blow him through there on some of these flies. It's also still an opportunity. We've seen him hand the football inside to Smith as well. And you can threaten the perimeter, and you can threaten the tackle box at the same time with both those running backs in the field.
Boy, on third and short, they went with Rodney Smith, didn't get there. No gain on the play, and now it's fourth down and about a yard and a half. Fountain was the first one there, then Dean came in there to finish him off.
Great play by safety Tony Anise. Look at him shoot. Timed it just right. Nobody there to block him. And he's all over Smith's legs before he could ever get going. Talk about the safety position for Central Michigan. They have to step up big. Frazier will. His counterpart is Tony Anise. Great play by number 18.
On fourth down and a couple, they'll punt it away. Thomas back to return the punt. He'll call for a fair catch at the 15. And he will take it. 44-yard punt. Jerry Kill, Minnesota hadn't won a bowl game in a long time. They've lost seven straight. He might be witnessing one here if the Gophers can hold on. Detroit, both teams spent Saturday volunteering at the Gleaners Food Bank on the east side of Detroit. Minnesota packed 17,000 pounds of potatoes, 1,300 backpacks. Central Michigan packed 18,000 pounds of potatoes, 1,400 backpacks. That's a lot of food. Handoff goes to Romello Ross. He is stopped after a gain of about a half a yard. It'll be second down and about now. So if you're Central Michigan, obviously your offense is predicated on throwing the football around. You have had little to no success. You're 9 of 20 for 74 yards through the air. You're averaging over 300 yards a game. What do you do offensively?
Well, that's the hard part, because coming into this, we talked about the play calling being balanced, but the production has been one-dimensional in the passing game. And the question was, coming into this, Minnesota's strength was in their secondary, their pass defense, one of the better units really in the country despite the injuries that they've experienced. And they're stronger now getting some of those bodies healthy.
Well, the screen game had worked a little bit earlier. Not now. Ross hit immediately by Jack Lynn, the junior outside backer. That's a loss of five. So now that's not even working.
That was the last bastion, really, when you look at the offensive production, because they have been able to slip Ross either in there on swing passes, hit him on a couple of screens. On the last possession, it was Julian Huff on a stunt. That time, Jack Lynn all over him. And the hard part is, how do you stretch the football field? Haven't been able to do it. See, those last five drives, had a kneel down in there at one point, four punts. It was that second possession where they put together a nice drive, and really, other than that, have not been able to threaten.
Boy, Cooper Rush trying to move that pocket out to the wide side of the field, but pressure again. Almost got hit right at the goal line. Good thing he got that one away. And now with 11 seconds to go here in the third quarter, here comes the Chippewa punt team one more time.
Now you're setting up great field position for the Gophers as well. Incapable of establishing any type of an offensive drive. Cooper Rush came into it. You know, he gets the football out, makes good decisions. He's been pressured a lot in this game. And that time it was a double barrel A-gap blitz on either side of the center. Nick Beamish able to get into the backfield.
Jack Oakley, the defensive back, punting out of the end zone, because Ron Caluzzi once again, the Chippewa's normal punter all season, decided to transfer right before the team came to Detroit. So they were scrambling in that regard, but he gets away a pretty good punt. Minnesota out in front. Third quarter has come to a close. 13-7 Golden Gophers. Fourth quarter on the other side. They have lost seven straight bowl games, tied with Ball State for the longest active streak. This is their 18th bowl appearance, 5-12 record. Mitch Leidner and company trying to hold on here, but still plenty of time, a full 15. Leidner will throw on first down, pass caught in Central Michigan territory. Drew Wolitarski picks up 6 yards.
You look at the way the Gopher defense has played in this game. They've done an excellent job slowly squeezing the life out of the Chippewa offense, really only allowing that one series early on in the first quarter. They've been tightening down on the bright spots of what the Chippewas have been able to do, moving the football offensively. They have had other opportunities to capitalize.
Shannon Brooks caught from behind, a loss of three. Nice play, and you get a feel for the first time. There's a little bit of energy coming from that Central Michigan defense.
They're starting to get after Minnesota up front, doing a good job of getting into that offensive backfield. If it's not harassing Mitch Leidner, it's getting to the ball carrier in the backfield. Great job off the edge that time by Chris Cantavelos.
Third down and six. Leidner throw is low. They're going to say the catch is made about a yard shy of the first down. Gain of five. KJ May scooping it up.
See right there, that ball, I mean, like it rolled off of his right forearm and was on the ground. Than a catch. I'm not sure the ground didn't help him maintain possession of that football. 2 yards to go.
Fourth down and a long. They're going to actually review this. Yeah. Here they go.
It looked to me, you know, the majority of the ball was on the ground. His right arm had rolled underneath it. It looked to me like as he was coming down with that football that most of it was on the turf.
I say review. They're all review. They're going to take a closer look.
Yeah, closer, longer look.
There is no action here on the field, but we're going to play the game here. Let's go.
Okay.
So they did review it, decided they don't need a closer, longer look. But you know what? We can.
Yeah, you know, to me, you see Leidner deliver this football low, and it looks like he's got the football. It looked like to me like his right arm was underneath the point of the ball. The rest of it was on the ground.
On fourth and two, coming near side. Pass is caught, but well shy. Might have even lost a yard. Well played by Central Michigan. Tony Anise comes up to make another outstanding play from his safety spot. That's the third or fourth time he has made a big play today.
We saw Anise earlier, the previous possession, Minnesota able to make a play in the short yards, come up and deny the yards needed. That time, able to wrestle big Brandon Lingen down. It's 245 pounds. It's the sixth tackle Tony Anise has made in this game. We've been talking about Kayvon Frazier. It's been the other safety for the Chippewa defense. And as you mentioned, Dave, you can sense some life, not only in that secondary, but also from the defensive front.
Cooper Rush hit as he throws. Caught out of bounds at the 36-yard line. Goes Corey Willis. 21-yard pickup.
Once again pressured, Cooper Rush, as his ball play develops off the play action. He gets hit by Steven Richardson. The ball seemed like it hung in the air forever, but a double move from Brian Body Calhoun. There's a guy that coming into this game, Morris Watts, offensive coordinator for the Chippewas. He felt like they could complete some balls in front of Calhoun, that he was a little bit less aggressive than Eric Murray.
Romello Ross to the 20-yard line. Another first down for the Chippewas. This may be the coming out party for the true freshman from right here in Detroit.
Great job by Romello Ross. Once again, I mentioned it earlier in the first half. For a true freshman, I think he sets his blocks as well as anybody. It was a great job of allowing the blocks to get established in front of him and then hitting for daylight. He has been the bright spot for this Chippewa offense for the bounce of this football, for the most part of this football.
From here in the Motor City, he has been the motor for the Chippewa offense. Falls forward to the 12-yard line. The young man over 5,000 yards rushing in high school, over 80 touchdowns as a running back in his high school career.
And now the Chippewa offense taking advantage of some of the play with this defense. It's a six-point game we're just talking about. As well as Minnesota has played defensively, the Chippewas have found ways to keep the Gophers from stacking points. So now we're looking at a six-point game, and here we are in the red zone.
83 yards on the ground on 17 carries for Ross. Out of the pistol, they'll give it to him again. Big hole off the right side. To the five, powers his way down to the two, to the one, touchdown!
A hometown hero, right? Come back here and make it worth your while. Right behind the block of Nick Beamish, the senior center. 50 starts in his career, and Austin Doan at left guard. And then the rest of the offensive personnel, everybody's a blocker. The Bush push to get him into the end zone. And Romello Ross, well, we said that we would sense it, we'd see him in this game. We've seen a lot of him. And an opportunity for the Chippewas to go ahead off a big fourth down stop at midfield. And Romello Ross powering that offense down to get in the end zone. Ramadan Ahmedi, everybody in there pushing, giving a little bit of a nudge. They're all blocking, of course. They're considered blocks, so that it's legal. They're just looking to get their ball carrier into the end zone. Look at Ross keeping his feet. Forward progress, still moving forward.
There is a ton of power in that 5 foot 10, 190 pound frame. The Chippewas looking to take the lead with the point after. And Evie splits them. How about this? Romello Ross on the year. 35 carries, 147 yards during the regular season. This is why you love bowl season. 18 carries, 96 yards.
New Year's Day on ESPN and streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
Well, the storyline right there for Central Michigan is first three drives this half, not very good. But when they needed a good one, they got it. And they have a one-point lead. K.J. May scoops up that kickoff return out to the 26-yard line. Well, welcome, Romello Ross. What a day he has had inside Ford Field.
Well, not only as a ball carrier, but as we mentioned in the first half, it was as a receiver on some screens and swing passes. But he just wouldn't be denied. You see the runs after contact, finding some of the daylight, setting up blocks very well. And on that last possession, it was all him. Really, three carries, 35 yards. None more important than that final touch where he and his entire, just about the entire team on the offense, helping Ross into the end zone for the go-ahead score.
Well, Minnesota's going to try to answer the bell now. They'll go to K.J. May. Good way to start it. Their leading receiver, over 100 catches in his career now. Picks up six.
The key for Minnesota is going to be avoiding these negative yardage plays that have derailed their drives. They open up this half, their first possession. They go right down the field. Then they get busted protection, big sack. You end up settling for a field goal. That very easily can be the difference in games like these. They'll have to start capitalizing on the momentum that they're establishing.
Swinging near side, Rodney Smith. Out of bounds, enough for the first down, 5 yards.
You know, works for Central Michigan. Why can't it work for Minnesota? You know, Mitch Leidner had a really good, has been putting together a really good game so far here today. The ground game has been more than supportive. We've seen Shannon Brooks and Rodney Smith contribute, sometimes lining up in the offensive formation at the same time.
They'll lay handoff. Smith coming near side. We'll get it close to the 45-yard line. Pickup of seven, Coleman. On the tackle for Central Michigan.
We've seen Minnesota establish drives, start marching the football. They seem to do best, obviously, when they can get a couple of those runs established and run off a play action. They've hit some nice passes downfield. Drew Walutarski has found his way open into the Chippewa secondary multiple occasions. Two big catches for him.
Quick throw, K.J. May trying to make a couple of guys miss. He'll have the first down near the 45 of Central Michigan. A gain of eight. Nathan Ricketts with his fifth tackle of the day.
A little bit more pace from the Minnesota offense now. Some more horizontal passing, stretching the field sideline to sideline. Central Michigan, he played well on defense, but there is a fatigue factor in there. Lewis Palmer playing a lot of snaps. Blake Serpa as well, number two, at his defensive end position.
Leidner, 21 and 25. Going down the middle, looking for May. Knocked away at the last moment. Josh Cox, step for step with K.J. May.
That's the formula. Run the football well, then set up a play action deep. Beautiful ball downfield. Excellent coverage by Cox. See him get his downfield hand right across the body of K.J. May, who's had a heck of a game in his own right.
Cox leads the team with seven passes broken up, but has a couple tonight, so give him nine on the year. Second down and 10. Rodney Smith picks up three, third down and seven. Clock's at 8:52 to go here in the fourth quarter. Quick lane bowl. Dave Neal, Matt Stinchcomb, Casey Smith down the sidelines. Glad you'd be with us from Detroit. Ford Field last night. Detroit Lions put it to the 49ers in this building. Both these teams had a chance to come witness the National Football League. Widener over the middle. There's K.J. May again. First down, Minnesota.
Time and time again, we have seen number one for Minnesota come up with the big catches in traffic. They brought him in motion. He came all the way across the formation, and then it's underneath Josh Cox, who was going for the breakup over his back. Fantastic breakup on the previous pass. That time, Cox incapable of getting it done. Good job that time getting the completion in traffic and extend the series and set it down.
For the 35, great handoff, Smith. Not much. We mentioned the NFL. Coach Bonamigo of Central Michigan. 16 years in the National Football League. Walked on to Central Michigan in 1983. Picked up a couple of letters as a player for the Chippewas. After coaching over 20 years, finally found his way back in his first season as the head coach at his alma mater. Leads him to a bowl game. He's coached in this particular building before, but in the National Football League. Trying to hold on here against Minnesota. Gain of seven. Lincoln again with another catch. The tight end up over 30 now this season. Just a sophomore. Leidner having a heck of a day throwing the football.
He's been dialed in. He really has. Yeah, they saw him a couple of touches. A few zone reads early on in this game, but it's been his arm that's been the difference in this game to complement some of the explosive runs they've gotten on the ground.
23 of 28, 217. Third down. Leidner keeps it. First down at the 20. Picks up seven. Anise tackles him.
What a fantastic read. I mean, you look at these quarterbacks in the ground game now, and you see it after the snap. Watch Serpa, the defensive end. He's going to crash. It's an easy read for the quarterback, Leidner, to just pull that football and get upfield. Excellent job by the quarterback there from Minnesota. Not only delivering the football in the passing game, knowing where to go with it, downfield, but also when called upon in the zone read.
5 minute drive. The 11th play is a handoff to Brooks. He'll pick up two. All right, it seems like a theme developing. They'll run up the middle, between the tackles, maybe try something to the outside. And then try to find K.J. May. Or
that's
maybe
right.
A little quarterback game.
Seems to be working well. You know, he's Tracy Clays, the defensive coordinator, understands. You know, diverse offensive attack. Easily the most difficult to defend. Ones where you don't know where you're going to be hit next. And this drive, mixing run pass well.
Eric Carter makes the catch. See where they spot it. Inside the 15, down to the 13. Ricketts with a tackle, but that'll pick up 5 yards, and now you're looking at third down and roughly four.
We've seen them find K.J. May on third downs. Brandon Ligon also at his tight end position, a key target where they choose to throw it, but already a third down conversion on the previous opportunity on the ground game with Leidner pulling the football and doing the read on the defensive end.
Six runs, six passes on this drive. Brooks in at running back. Leidner keeps it, big hole. Touchdown, Minnesota. 13 yards, and the Gophers have the lead.
If you had to draw a drive up, from a balance standpoint, if you're the quarterback, if you're the play caller, you can't be happier than that execution. Right down the football field, Leitner does a fantastic job once again in the read game and also getting upfield quicker. Twice on that possession with a quarterback from Minnesota doing an excellent job of keeping that football on the ground.
And Minnesota going to go for two here. What a drive. 13 plays, 74 yards, 6:36 off the clock. A five-point game, trying to make it seven. They'll work out of the pistol. Leitner under pressure. Throws back. K.J. May has it. ...21-14 Gophers.
It almost looked like a broken play. Either somebody blew the fake in the backfield. Either way, Leitner finding a way to get it done, keeping this play alive. It was mostly him getting in the zone the first time, but for the two-point conversion, finding K.J. May in the back of the end zone to complete a drive and go up a touchdown.
Well, we have had four lead changes here at the Quick Lane Bowl. Minnesota just took the lead right back from Central Michigan on that 74-yard drive. Great balance. Capped off by the 13-yard scamper from Mitch Leitner. Kickoff goes into the end zone. Out to the 25, we will play. Capital One Bowl Mania continues tomorrow at 2 Eastern with the Lockheed Martin Armed Forces Bowl as Cal battles Air Force. Then at 5:30, it's the Russell Athletic Bowl as North Carolina takes on Baylor. Then at 9, it's the AdvoCare V100 Texas Bowl between LSU and Texas Tech. It's the most wonderful time of the year. All games are on ESPN, also streaming live on the ESPN app. But we still have 4:26 to go here in Detroit. Central Michigan put together a nifty drive their last possession. It was basically all Romello Ross, a true freshman. Four plays, 56 yards. Ross took it in from 13 yards out to give the Chippewas a lead briefly. Cooper Rush. Pass caught. Broken tackle. There goes Corey Willis. 19 yards.
The one thing that Minnesota can't let happen is for the big play to break. And this time, Boddy Calhoun coming up, trying to make the tackle on Corey Willis. He gets the big yards after the catch, something that this Minnesota secondary has done an excellent job of preventing all season long. Have to make sure that they force Central Michigan to earn it as they protect a touchdown lead.
Rush coming near side, and pass is caught. Jesse Kroll picks up seven more. 3:45 and counting.
The diving catch for Jesse Kroll. We've seen another from him earlier in this game. See him pop that football up with his right hand. Looked like he completed that catch cleanly.
Second down and three. They'll go handoff with Ross. He's to the 45, has the first down.
That's the challenge that they're presented with now. On that previous possession, Romello Ross establishing that ground game would not be denied, running between those tackles. We knew that the concern for Minnesota was Central Michigan's ability to distribute the football to multiple receivers. They've done a great job just about all game of clamping down on the perimeter passing.
Ross just hit 100 yards on the ground. Leitner throwing, far side. Batted away at the last moment, there are no flags.
Going after Boddy Calhoun again. Previous pass, Corey Willis. See him matched up. Stride for stride, they're going for the back shoulder, and Willis had an opportunity to make that completion. You see Cooper Rush. Disappointed that he didn't come away with a big catch downfield once again.
Cooper Rush came in completing 67% of his passes, averaging 308 yards per game. He is at 13 for 26, 116 yards today. Four-man rush. Underneath pass caught. Eric Cooper, the sophomore out of Flint, Michigan, picks up 3 yards. But the clock moving to 2:44. Both teams with 3 timeouts remaining.
Plenty of time left yet. Once again, you talk about Minnesota wanting to defend the sticks. Field goal doesn't really help them right here, of course. You've got 4-down territory. You don't have to get the full 7 yards and convert right here. You can make it manageable.
Rush gets it away, and it is picked off. Bonnie Calhoun comes up with the pick.
The first quarter, we saw Mitch Leidner trying to make something happen over the middle when he scrambled up in the pocket. That time, Julian Huff, true freshman, once again rushing off the edge, got Cooper Rush off of his spot, trying to make something happen over the middle, and Bonnie Calhoun makes him pay.
Bray and Bonnie Calhoun, they were trying to pick on him this drive. This time he picks on Central Michigan. Inters have 3 timeouts remaining. Mitch Leidner and company trying to close this one out and snap a 7-game bowl losing streak. Their last win came back in 2004, the Music City Bowl. First down and 10 after the interception. They'll give it to Shannon Brooks. There is the first of those timeouts taken by the Chippewas. Well, tonight after Monday Night Football, stick around for SportsCenter at night with Scott Van Pelt. He will handle the postgame wrap-up the SVP way. Plus, don't miss his 10 things. There are 10 games.
There are. You got to get to the 6th tiebreaker for the Colts to get in, which could happen.
Oh, my goodness. Crazy. 21-14 here, pretty simple. Minnesota needs to hold on to the football for 2:06. Leidner, 24 of 29, 221 through the air, a touchdown and one interception. A little shoulder fake. They're going to throw it. That will stop the clock with 2:02 to play. They were trying to hit K.J. May on a deep slant.
Had him. But the play call itself is curious, given the fact that they've ran the football relatively well, and you could either bleed more time or force a timeout to be burned. Incomplete pass, worst case scenario. Obviously, you get the first down, he's probably still running.
They'll hand it off. Big hole. There's your first down. Shannon Brooks. Maybe they just knew they were going to pick up the first down with Brooks. Maybe that was simple as that. 10-yard pickup.
That's what it was. Yeah. Just like when Central Michigan took the field and forced a timeout. That's what they were doing. It worked out well. Shannon Brooks bails them out here. Picking up the first down. This is your 4-minute offense. You're playing with a lead. Trying to force those timeouts. Shorten this football game.
Chippewas have to take a timeout. 1:55 to play.
Some are seduced.
Began at 6, so you have been locked in. Hopefully been clicking back and forth. Just about to wrap it up here, and then you can get over there and watch Monday Night Football. First down and 10. Leidner will keep it. Chippewas trying to strip it out of there. Lake Serpa trying to get it out of the hands of Leidner, but just not going to give up that football.
Another. A little bit of a muddy exchange it looked like on that one, Dave. I don't know. It's I don't know if Leidner rode him. He rode Brooks a long time. You see there? That ball popped out for a second. Lake Serpa thought he had an opportunity to come in there and get it out. The one thing you can't have happen. They were on defense. The one thing they couldn't let happen. Get a big play and yards after catch. Corey Willis was almost able to do that. They end up getting the turnover. Now on offense, the last thing you can do is fumble the football, give it back to these guys midfield with a minute 50 to play. game, though, by that kid, number seven. It's been kind of a tough year, I think, for Minnesota. They played some really good defenses, six top 25 scoring defenses in the country. Big Ten has been a tough conference. Hadn't had a clear identity all season long, really. The running back position clarified there towards the end of the season.
Second down and seven. They'll go with Brooks. Picks up four, so now you're looking at third down and three.
Central Michigan, there's no way to stop the clock at this point. Big opportunity, chance for Minnesota. Pick up the first, ice this game. Get your first win in seven tries. Bowl game. A long time. That would mean a lot for this program, but obviously one that has been in transition this year at the head coaching position with the resignation of Jerry Kill.
Certainly Coach Kill has to take a lot of pride in the fact that this team, this foundation, he laid it. I mean, it's his hard work, and it's a shame due to health issues that he can't continue on, but I think he saw the big picture, and as he said, it was, he wasn't sleeping much. He was just fighting it every single day, and there's more to it than just football, and it took a while, but he finally realized it. And I think it's a prideful moment for him.
You'd have to think so, right? I mean, it's a guy that he's done nothing but turnaround jobs. He did it Southern Illinois, did it Northern Illinois. Makes a jump to Minnesota. This will be their fourth straight bowl game. Finally get a victory perhaps in this postseason. It certainly looks that way. And he mentioned, you know, he expected this program to make a big jump in year six and seven.
5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Well, tonight's Capital One player of the game. We give it to Coach Kill, I guess, if you wanted to. But we're going to give it to that guy, Mitch Leidner. What a day. 24-32, 23, two total touchdowns. When he had to make the throws, he made them. When he had to make the runs, he made them.
Attacking on to that record, you know, his 23rd rushing touchdown. It's a big one. You know, look at what he was able to do today offensively. The Gopher defense played well versus a prolific passing attack.
The punt is away. Thomas will let it hit and goes out of bounds. Another outstanding kick from Peter Mortel. This guy is a magician with the punts. The second time he has spun one out of bounds inside the five. Before we get out of here, we must mention Coach Bonamingo of Central Michigan. It has been obviously a great year to be named head coach at your alma mater, but he went through some situations, yes, with his tonsil cancer that I wouldn't wish on your worst enemy. He fought through it. Even when people said you shouldn't be around the team, he went to his cancer treatments, the chemo, the radiation, still went to meetings, practices, fought through it, wanted to be around the team. And he said he was honored and privileged to do it, even the pain he was in. And I just talking to him, what a great man. And I think the future is bright for Central Michigan.
No question. Great coach and a prideful coach, a guy that clearly cares about Central Michigan and their football program, and more importantly, their kids that are playing for him right now. He sacrificed a lot to get this team where they are.
So 4 seconds left on the clock. One last chance. They had one last chance in the Bahamas Bowl last year.
That's right.
Almost pulled it out against Western Kentucky.
Slightly less passing yards in this one, I think. But you look at Cooper Rush, to dial him out. A valiant effort in this game.
Minnesota secondary back at the 20-yard line. Minnesota wants to take a timeout just to make sure they get everybody situated.
Seen some crazy endings in college football this season, that's for sure. You're looking like the Miami Duke games, BYU Hail Marys. A lot of things can happen. You certainly want to make sure your defense is dialed in for one last-ditch effort.
Well, it was right about, I guess, happened to be around, I don't know, it was 12 years ago, 13 years ago, the Bluegrass Miracle, the LSU and Kentucky game. I happened to be doing that one way back when, and the ball was somewhere in this area. I can't remember, 20-yard line or so.
Rohan Davey, right, at quarterback?
Marcus Randall.
Oh, Marcus Randall, that's right.
Heaved it down and went through about six Kentucky defenders. Not sure how that happened, but it did. So you just never know.
It's the ground ball that leaves the infield, right? How right. will they get in there?
So Cooper Rush will be dropped, and that'll do it, and the streak is over. The Gophers win the Quick Lane Bowl 21-14 and snap the streak at 7. Their first bowl win since 2004. Tracy Clays, as the head coach of Minnesota, picks up the win. And Minnesota becomes the third team with a losing record this season to win a bowl game.
Says something. Hey, man, go to class. Stay on track to graduate. Get your chance to go in the postseason with all these bowl games. And they've earned it, all three of them.
Mitch Leidner was a story offensively, but what a job this Minnesota defense did today on Cooper Rush. They held him to 145 yards through the air, normally throwing for 308. A balanced effort from Minnesota. 21-14, our final score. And Minnesota will finish up the season 6-7. Central Michigan goes to 7-6. So the trip well worth it for the Minnesota fans. Let's go down to Casey.
Coach, congratulations. This team's first bowl win since 2004, a season full of adversity. What can you say about this team through this season?
Well, it's a great thing, you know, for everything we've been through and with Coach and the injuries. But our seniors, I'll tell you what, to be the first group to win a bowl game since 2004 in our first group, I mean, I think the world of those kids. And then to get picked the bowl because of the APR with the standards that our senior class set. So proud for the seniors, be a good jump start into the offseason. Then our great fans, state of Minnesota, they deserve this. They've been awfully patient, and it's only bigger and better from here on out.
When you mentioned Coach being on the sideline and how important that is, what does this mean to you that he's here tonight to witness this?
To me, the kids, everybody, we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Jerry Kill. And I tell you, he's the best football coach I've ever been around. And it's what happened, you know, it makes you take a lesson. It can always be taken away from you in a hurry. But save times, it teaches you can win and still be a good person like Jerry Kill.
What is the future of this program?
So the principal, we want to be.
Thank you so much, Coach. Congratulations.
All right, thank you, Casey. Mitch Leidner and company celebrating the victory as Minnesota beat Central Michigan 21-14. Coming up next, the Maggie Dixon Classic between Maryland and UConn.